Thank you, Yuval, and welcome everyone. First of all, thank you MATC for hosting this webinar, our training facility in Israel in Shfaim. Today we have the topic of irrigation and fertigation. I wanted to take less than 1 minute to emphasize the importance of this area of activity that we have in each center of excellence under the IIAP. This area, in my opinion, is one of the main pillars of what we do. And therefore, we all the time add layers on this, what I call language of irrigation and fertigation. Because definitely you have all been going through trainings along the year on basics and principles of irrigation and fertigation. Some of you have advanced very much and today are practicing very accurate irrigation and fertigation. But this is a never-ending training. We always add more layers, we always learn more lessons, and definitely with the reality of COVID-19, we need to adapt and to make sure that we apply irrigation and fertigation solution, although a situation is challenging and the ability to reach the field is not always there. And definitely us as project officers of centers of excellence, we cannot always engage face-to-face with our farmers. So this area of activity that we are going to highlight today will be delivered by Moshe. We will divide it into two parts. Moshe will present each of the parts. One will talk about the system as different aspects of the system of irrigation and fertigation. And the other part will be dealing with the agronomy of irrigation and fertigation. And in each part, we will stop after presenting the part and have a Q&A so we can address specific questions for each lecture. So at this stage, I will hand it over to Moshe. And at the end, we will recap everything. And my request is, let us go out of this webinar with action items. Because at the end of the day, you are the leaders, the people in the centers. You will be the one generating the knowledge and transferring it to the farmer. So thank you for this, and Moshe, please.
Okay, good morning and thank you. First, thank you for inviting me to this webinar. I will just share my screen and then present myself. Just a minute, please. Okay, can you see this my screen?
Okay. Dan?
Can you hear me?
Yes, we can see your screen, Moshe. Go ahead.
Okay, and do you hear me? It's okay?
We can hear you very well.
Okay, thank you. So, first, let's present myself. I'm Moshe Broder, as mentioned, and I visited India in this project some years ago. I'm agricultural engineer in the field of soil, water, irrigation, and agroagriculture. Ecology, of course. We are going to talk today about the irrigation fertigation, and I want to have this short presentation in, divided by two sections. I'll finish the first one, and this is our agenda for today. Some introduction about communication, and then we are going to talk about water and irrigation systems and irrigation fertigation. I want to have a Q&A session after this part, and then we'll continue for the second part of the presentation for the irrigation certification. We'll start with communication, and I understand that all of us are interested in the communication nowadays. I want to talk about two different but combined parts. One is the communication platforms or devices, and we can see here the various ways we can communicate each other. So we can talk about electronic devices. We can we know the communication applications, and of course softwares and other applications. So there are some, everyone has a smartphone, someone has a tablet, PC or laptop, and of course controller. We know Facebook, WhatsApp, Zoom, what we use just now, and all the office softwares. I understand that you is it okay, Yuval? Yuval?
Okay.
It's okay, you hear me?
Yeah, we hear you very well.
Okay, thank you. And this Mana application, I understand that some of you already use it. In the other end, I want to talk about so let's call all these components as communication platforms, but not less important is not only the devices or the applications, but how can you communicate each other? What we call interpersonal communication or interpersonal skills. And I want us to focus the importance of how we would communicate between ourselves, between an expert and a farmer, or every communication, personal communication, to ensure we know how to explain, how to deliver our message in the right way. And maybe we can think in our case about this communication, okay? So I want us to take the message of be aware about how can we deliver our message in the best way, so the farmer or our colleagues will understand what we want to say, what we want to deliver. This is about communication. Now, let's go to the first part of this presentation about water supply systems, and I want to distinguish between water supply systems and irrigation systems. Of course, irrigation system depends on the supply of water, and we talk about mainly about capacity and about reliability. I think these two components are very important, and if we know how to build the systems in the right way, we can ensure high reliability and high performance of our systems. So when we talk about water supply systems, first we refer to water sources. Here we can see a canal, a well, borehole or bore well. If we know these kinds of water sources, but there are also reservoirs or dams. Here we can see a river and a diversion canal. When we take some of water of the main river to the site to irrigate our fields, and there are of course some more types of water sources. Now, as usual, we have to apply energy in order to be able to utilize this water for irrigation in our case or for any other uses. Here we can see two pumping stations. So let's talk about pumps. Here there is one pump. Here we can see another type of pump. And the pumping station, which includes some components like the pump itself, the electrical panel, other sensors and the pipes and other components of the station. Here we can see electrical operated pumps, and here we can see diesel. It's not electrical. This is a diesel which operates this gear, and the pump is just here inside. And of course, there are some various sizes, because this is very small, relatively very small system which supply water to a poultry farm here. The capacity of this two pumps is only about 15 cubic meters per hour. Here we see a much bigger system. These two pumps serve a farm of about 500 hectares of orchards and the field crops. And the capacity of this system is about 700 cubic meter per hour. So we can think about many, many systems. And the key factor for success is how we design it, how we build it or construct it, and of course, how we maintain, and we'll mention it later on, all these important issues. Thanks for the dissenters who sent some data. So we can see here the water source is borehole or bore well, and the discharge is about 10 cubic meter per hour. There are some details about the pumps. Here we can see another place of a water tank of about 500 cubic meter, and the discharge or water flow is 40 cubic meter per hour. And another one, when we see the water canal with the more than 6,000 cubic meter, and the discharge is about 70 cubic meter per hour. So we see even in this project there are different combinations of water sources and water supply systems. Now, I want to talk about irrigation systems. And first I want to have a short introduction of how can we utilize some high-tech devices in order to help ourselves and our farmers to be able to continue and build systems and maintain them. So I'll present you just very fresh in these days. I am a member of a research station in Israel, which we design here, not an orchard, but this is a layout of irrigation experiment. We can see here many, many colors. And in, to make it short, there are about 11 treatments of irrigation. Now, as you know, our options to meet each other is very limited nowadays under the corona conditions. And we now we use, not only now, but I want us to see the option, and I'll try to present, sorry. Okay. I want to show you another software which called SketchUp. Can you see this model, Yuval? Okay. Look, we build a model of this greenhouse. And we built inside the whole structure, like the beds, laterals, the color of each treatment. Here we have some treatments which will plant in the soil. And also we have some soilless treatments. So we can see here the container and the system for collecting the drainage, everything we can just draw inside and communicate with each other by this software. Here there are some tanks of fertilizers and irrigation solutions, many components. It's not our subject about intensive farming, but I want us to understand, and we'll see later another example, how can we utilize this SketchUp or any software to communicate each other and just assimilate the all the details in the right way. We have the dimensions, as you can see here, and we can determine almost everything and communicate each other in the right way. Now I'll go back to the presentation. Okay. Okay, so the first stage I want to talk about is the design and construction of irrigation system. And again, I have here some pictures of which I got from you, from the centers. We can see a water meter, valves. If we have a closer look, you can see there is a manifold, and this is electric or hydraulic valve. Some filters, there is an automatic disc filter and sand filter here. And fertigation system with a Venturi injectors, irrigation controller, many, many components. And I want to present a case from the last year. Here, there is a mango orchard in Israel, and the farmer asked me to design an enhancement of this control head, because it was very old and it was not reliable enough. So I came to the area, I took this some pictures of the old system, and first I asked the map of the area. So we can see here this area, the control head is located here, and there are 10 subplots. Each one is irrigated by itself. There are some valves and some sub system. We are not going to talk about all these details, but one of the steps of design is to analyze the hydraulic conditions. So there are some plots, we talked about 10 subplots. The distance between rows, and this data I got from you also, distance between trees, the running length of lateral, the area, and in Israel, we determined the area by dunam. In India, as I remember, is by acre, sometimes by hectares. So 1 acre is 4 dunams, and 1 hectare is 10 dunams. The discharge of the dripper, spacing between drippers, number of laterals per row, irrigation rate, water flow of discharge of the each subplot, and very important parameter of maximum daily requirement or that maximum daily application, which is as usual at the peak day, at the hottest and dry days. Here we determined as 8 millimeters per day. Now this is very important to analyze and design, because the calculation will lead us to the application or irrigation duration. How long we have to irrigate each plot. So we see here almost 4 hours for each plot, and we have to plan and schedule the irrigations according the time we have. So here we have to irrigate almost around the day, almost 22 hours. In this, because it's only four plots, 15 hours it's enough. This is very, very tight, and the system should be very reliable to be able to irrigate almost around the day. We cannot expand the talking about this importance of analyzing the details and the conditions, but again, I think it's very, very important for us to know what are the requirements of our system and how to design. Let's go on. We presented the general layout of the system. You can see here the control valve and valve and water meter and other components as fertilizer tanks and this to the plot, and also design of the control components. So we have some control devices like injectors and valve, hydraulic or electric valves. There is an automatic filtration system and also some inputs to the controller, which some of them are discrete, which is on or off, and analog inputs when we have the value, but again, we don't have enough time today to get into it. I believe most of us know this devices and sensors. Now we can see again the ability of this SketchUp. We draw the control head with all components, the filters and the valves and pipes, the fertilizer tank. The dimensions are here, and we just can give it to the farmer or to the constructor to build the system. You can see it from another angle, and I want us to focus on one of the important details. Here we can see three elements of automatic filtration system, but there is another place which is not equipped now, and in the catalog we can see a system like here, like this. We suggest, we offer to order a bigger one, which is the same capacity, but the potential for another unit. Why? Sometimes we want to change the characteristics of the system. Like we want to add another plot, subplot. Sometimes we want to increase the discharge of the system. So it's very easy and cheap just to add one unit of filtration, and that opens the whole system if we order in the beginning only this one, system. Okay, but there are many examples we can talk about this. About management and maintenance, because we have a short time, I want just to emphasize that how to manage the system, and especially how to maintain the all components to be sure. The sensors and the pumps and tanks, everything very important, and this issue or this part of the game of irrigation is very important all around the EU. Again, we don't have enough time to expand it today. Now I want to have a break for Q&A. Yuval, do we have some questions? Yuval?
Okay. Moshe, you finished the first lecture. Thank you very much.
First part. My question is, I don't see now, just a minute, the if we have already some questions about this.
No, there's no question written yet.
No question. Okay.
Any questions?
Please, gentlemen, ladies and gentlemen, if you have any question, this is your time to ask question before we start the second part of the lecture. And it's better if you do it on the chat button that we can see, me and Moshe can see the your questions. Dan, you on unmute?
Yes, so definitely in the meanwhile when participants will write questions, I want to emphasize a few very important things Moshe was going through. I think as a starting point, we all must be experts on our irrigation fertigation systems. We at the same time must have the companies that are actually providing the solution. We must supervise and make sure the design and installation is being done in the right way. So Moshe gave different inputs. I would highlight the fact that when you do a system, make sure the right components are in place. It's actually a checklist to see that you have the right filtration, you have a water meter, you have the valves, you have the fertigation, and so on. Secondly, you must have flexibility. The system must be able to adapt itself to the needs today and in years to come. Because putting an irrigation system must have a vision. It's not only day number one. So this is another takeaway I take from what Moshe was saying. I would say that our responsibility as owners of the system is to be an expert on the system in terms of maintaining the system, because any system will require maintenance, but also for us to know the system. And I love the table you showed, Moshe. I always take the irrigation rate as a starting point for all of us. When we know the irrigation rate of every shift we have in our system, then actually we know how to irrigate. When we know our system characteristics in terms of how much water it delivers every hour, then we know how to implement irrigation. So this is the second part. The last part is that now we all have a little bit more time to sit in our office or at home and do some work. What I suggest to all of you is please review your irrigation system, I would say design, so know it by heart. Second, know your irrigation rate and know your characteristic of system is second. And third, generate knowledge to farmers. And the knowledge to farmers can go into different ways. I will leave second part for Moshe to deliver, but you need to educate farmers also on what and how to talk to the companies that are installing systems, what to ask for, how to know that what you ask for is actually being installed in your field, and also tell them no irrigation rate, because irrigation rate will in the future be the way that you communicate as a center with your farmers. So these are the points I wanted to say. What I suggest, I do not know if we have questions from audience, but I do suggest we continue to second part, and maybe okay. We will take questions together at the end.
Okay, let's go.
Okay, I can see there's no, there is question coming now. Moshe, can you see the question?
Just a minute, please.
Let me read it for you until you find it. Does the system will change as per soil type? Does macro sprinkler system better than drip system in lateric soil?
Okay. I think this question is belongs to the second part. Okay, because it's not in the aspect but agronomic aspect. Okay.
Okay, so you want to go to do your second part of the lecture?
Yeah. Okay, let's go on and we'll keep this question for the next one.
Okay, go ahead, please. You can start the second.
Okay.
You can start the second part of the lecture.
Okay. So, we'll talk about two parts. One is the irrigation scheduling and monitoring. The second one will be about fertilizers, litigation, and so on. This table I got from Laduasi here, and we refer to phenological stages. I think we and all of us understand that water requirement depends on many, many factors like phenological stage, climate conditions, soil properties, as like the last question we have here, and other parameters. So, here we have we can see various stages of like vegetative flowering. Of course, all of us know these stages from the field. Again, we can see here the flowering stage. Another stage, not during the flowering season. Every stage has its own water requirements and of course also fertilizers. We'll talk about it later. So we have different phenological stages and of course the size of trees, because just after planting the water requirement is relatively low. For matured or developed trees, the water requirement is higher. Another issue is if we have exposed soil or mulched. Here we can see, and again, it's from your centers, we can see here exposed soil where the evaporation from water soil surface will be higher, or if the ridge or the row is mulched, we both we minimize the herbs development, but also we minimize the evaporation from soil surface. So every component of these examples will affect the water requirement. Now, again, this picture I got from you, and this is a topic. Now, I just want to mention that I recognize here my friend and my partner, Eli, that's right. And we see this is another example of canopy management. I wanted to mention that after the headed back process, after 2 years, we can see here very nice canopy. But I'm sure that in the first year, the canopy was limited, so water requirement was lower. In this stage, is higher, and I believe that in the year after, the water requirement was even higher than in this year. So the parameters we have to refer or to take in consideration when we plan our irrigation schedule, and the program is a bit complicated, but it's possible. And we can see here very, very nice canopy and the very vital leaves and canopy. Here we can, again, it's from the from Ladois. This is the data I got. I just arranged some components in this graph, but we can see here the yellow bars for the ET, which in this season it was from almost 0 to 4 millimeters per day. The KC, or the crop coefficient for irrigation, was about 0.45, this blue bars we can see here in the on the right, and the irrigation, which is which is the multiplier of the ET and the KC, which is presented by the red line, which is suggested. Of course, we can add here the actual irrigation which we applied, but this is one of the devices we have to help us to design our, or to plan our irrigation in the field. We can see, just look here, 2 days where the ET, the evaporative transpiration, was very low, and we can see that the calculation is accordingly. Okay, so I think this is one of the tools we have to, we can plan our irrigation. Another example I want to show from Israel, just one of the examples we in the team help our farmers to monitor the irrigation. It's not mango and not pomegranate, but the olive orchard. We can see here during the last month, the irrigation of 7 subplots of different soils and different varieties. We can see here the water application, the daily water application, which is determined by millimeter. This season, it's relatively low, about 1 millimeter per day. And the last week, there were some hot days, hot and dry days, and the farmer increased the irrigation dose. And as a routine, we have another graph, which represent the cumulative irrigation for each plot. You see, this is for each month, and this is for in the running month, and there is a graph which accumulate the application from the beginning of year 2020, and till now there are about between 50 to 60 millimeter per each subplot, depending on the variety and the stage of each plot. So it's very easy for the farmer and for us as consultants to see what happens if something happens like this. So here, you can see here, I didn't present, I go back. You can see here, we had the farmer had problem with one of the plots, didn't irrigate. He fixed it and completed the application afterwards. So by this graph, we can recognize if there are some problems or some other reasons of failure of irrigation, and just to fix it in, let's call it, almost real time. So this is an Excel file, relatively very simple, and it's very useful and easy to use. I want to go to the last part of fertilizers, fertilization, fertigation. We know that fertigation is the combination of irrigation and fertilization, but I want us just to refer to some examples you sent, and this is one of the documents I got from you. There are some different fertilizers and the amount of material or fertilizer that the farmer applies. Here we can see another document, and if we enlarge, we can see here some stage of flowering, 50 to 70 days, the fertilizer and the amount, and fruiting and so, and it's very nice. I was very happy to see all these details. I didn't check them, but I think that if a farmer refers to the different phenological stages, it means he knows that every stage requires different irrigation amount, and of course different nutrition elements and the amount. About soil, so we got some different data documents about soil, pH, EC, organic carbon in this example, and I want, and of course the time is limited, but how to plan the nutrition program for the season and by the multi years, it's another issue. It's a very wide topic. We can talk it about it in another option. I want us just to remember that the soil characteristics like pH, EC, which represent the salinity or the salt content, and the all the nutrients, is a wide topic. We can talk about it in maybe another option, another time. Of course, the water properties like pH again, EC, salt contents, and the nutrients is another. I think we can, if there are some questions, let's have them now. I think our time is over. That's right, Yuval? Yuval?
Yes, Moshe.
I think our time is almost over.
Yes.
So if there are some...
This is the time for the Q&A session.
Yes.
So please, if you have any questions. So this is the time to write in the, like I said, in the chat button. Or if you want to... And I can open, the microphone. I can unmute everybody. And if you want to try and ask questions, this is the time.
Don't unmute the question. And start with the new questions we already have. Not unmute.
Too many people, I will unmute you again. Moshe, maybe you can start with to answer the first question.
Yes, I don't see the questions. Can you help me?
Yes, the question was, does the system will change as per soil type? Does micro sprinkler system better than drip system in lateratic soil?
Okay. The connection between soil properties and nutrition and irrigation method is, of course, we have to talk about it. It's a very wide topic. But if to be very more specific about difference between sprinklers or micro sprinklers and drip irrigation. As usual, we know that in many cases we can achieve better results by drip irrigation. We have to consider the wind conditions if we think about sprayers or micro sprinklers. I think there is a very important reason to use or to design a sprinkler, I think it's it's a very, very difficult to maintain such a system in the right way. So if there is no reason to use the drip irrigation, I think most of the cases we see that drip irrigation enable us to have a better performance.
Yes. Moshe, I want to ask a question, maybe on behalf of all centers.
Yes.
If the centers were to develop some kind of a guideline for drip irrigation to serve, so farmers can make use of it. So yes. How would you approach such a task that you need to bring a few principles of drip? Maybe we can provide them, because you don't need to invent the literature. Maybe we can provide them with some structures, and in this to already put solutions or steps on how do you analyze your soil in the aspect of drip irrigation? How do you analyze sprinkler or drip? These big questions that all of us should know when we communicate with farmers, because these are questions that come from the farmers.
Yes. Okay. So,
on a principle level, only principle. No, I'm not asking for guideline now.
Of course. As I mentioned, I think that, that it should be a very serious reason to choose sprinklers for irrigation, yes, not for the, we use sprinklers and micro sprinklers and the sprayers for many, many purposes. But in open field, as usual, we prefer to use drippers. Now GPLs have a large scale of wide scale of discharges, like water flow from less than 1 liter per hour up to 4 and much more, a higher value. In general, nowadays we prefer to have a small spacing of between drippers and low discharge or low flow at each dripper. Again, it depends on the water quality. If water is very clean and the particles or the filter system is well designed and well maintained, we prefer to utilize drippers like 1 liter per hour, and the distance between drippers about 30-25 centimeters, like this. The water distribution and nutrients distribution is much better. So the availability of water and nutrients for the root system is much, much better. Again, it means we have to maintain our system carefully to be sure that we're not on the process of clogging because of dirt or some problems of water quality. It's not only particles, but there are also the chemical and biochemical properties of water, like chemical sedimentation and so. I think, in general, I prefer, no doubt, I prefer drip irrigation. If the water quality doesn't enable us to use drippers, so we can utilize micro sprinklers. Again, I wanted to remember some of micro sprinklers are also sensitive to water quality, and the clogging is a common phenomenon. Clogging of micro sprinklers, so it's not free of filtration requirements.
Of course. Of course, I would, you know, I would definitely take your position. We are promoting drip as our solution for irrigation. And in this regard, what I am asking project officers to do is or refresh the existing protocol for drip irrigation, or if you don't have, actually generate one. You can use our experience. I think Moshe gave valuable aspects, both on the system aspect and the agronomy aspect. And on the level of principle on how to take a drip irrigation in this regard, I ask every center to develop its own protocol tailored to the local conditions in the local language, because these in many times are the reason when a farmer will feel confident to approach and to adopt this solution to his field. When he feels he has somebody to go back and ask questions, somebody to get the advice from. So you as centers of excellence have the responsibility to deliver these type of tools in the hands of the farmer. Yuval, do we have any additional questions?
Yes, we have two questions. The first question is, what is the basis of two values of crop coefficient in mango?
Again, please.
Yuval, sorry?
Again, yes, please.
What is the basis of two values of crop coefficient in mango?
What is two value?
You show the graph KC 0.4 and 0.45.
Ah, okay, okay. Okay. This. That's right?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. As I see here, the KC was 0.4, and in this case, in this was at January, and this was at February. The pop coefficient is bigger by 0.05 than in January. I suppose it's or the canopy is more developed, or the climate conditions became more dry and hot, or the combination of it. This is the reason that the crop coefficient change from one step to another.
What is important to add, with your permission, I would appreciate if you can address it also, Moshe. When developing KC, it is always responsibility of the locals to tailor the KC. There is no one KC for all the world. Every region, every variety, even every season, it is a dynamic value that must be adopted. So it is based on phenological stage and of the climate. We shared at the time what is a KC for mango in Israel, but emphasized all the time that KC cannot be copy-paste from Israel to India, but it also cannot be copy-paste from Karnataka to Haryana. So every place must adopt a KC. And these two values Moshe was presenting are two values in 2 months. In addition, we have 10 more months with different values of KC. So we all should bear in mind that this is, again, only as an example and not as a recommendation or a guideline.
Absolutely right. I want us just look at January. We see that the ET is lower than February. It's very reasonable. But I focused before these 2 days. Look, the KC is okay, but even with already adapted the KC for our conditions, we must be aware about the changes from day to day. So there are some seasons that it's very, very dramatic. Look, it's about double or maybe 50% more here than in these days. And farmers should care about the actual conditions and react. And the KC is, let's say, it's a guideline. But always we should notice that the conditions are changing, especially in the transient season. And I think this is a very good example. Here we can see the phenomena of changing conditions dramatically from day to day.
Okay, there's a last question.
Yes.
Okay, does irrigation change flavor and aroma of fruits? Farmers in mango belt not giving irrigation as they think stress give good taste. What do you think about it, Moshe?
Okay, first I want to say that I'm sure it is. And I want to say another part of my answer that I cannot answer specifically for this case. The flavor, the taste, and all the characteristics of fruit are affected by many, many parameters, like irrigation and nutrition and the tree or the plant health and the radiation, aeration or every exposure to fresh air. So the health of the plant and the vitality of the various phenological stages, all these parameters will affect the yield and of course the quality of yield. So I think it's very complicated, and every farmer should learn and know the conditions in his field. I am sure that if we improve the conditions and improve the availability of water, nutrients, not too much, but not less, and the timing of treatments, it will affect, but not everything is water and the fertilizers, the timing of canopy management, the timing of applying pesticides if it needs, if we control the herbs, the weeds, everything will affect the performance of the field.
Yes, I would add on top, Moshe, with your permission, that we definitely know that irrigation can have an impact when managed correctly. For example, if you irrigate 100% the plant requirements compared to a regulated deficit irrigation, where a plant doesn't get what it would optimally want, this deficit can lead to change of characteristic in sugar accumulation in the fruit, in acidity concentration, and this can result in different character in the taste and the aroma. I think there are two ways to take it. First of all, naturally, such a research should be dealt on a research level, with a university, with researchers which are dedicated to analyze and to see the different treatments. But maybe a center can take a demonstration where it can show extremes and see what it comes up with. You as a project officer that are here listening to what Moshe is lecturing, you can decide if you want to take such a challenge as part of your work plan. And if so, you should plan for a 3-4 year demonstration that will compare 100% to a regulated deficit irrigation in different phenological stages, may perhaps when fruit maturity is happening, to implement some deficit and to see the impact. But this is an option. I think at this stage, we can recap and summarize the 1 hour webinar Moshe was leading. I would say this field of irrigation and fertigation must be always in our minds whenever we put together a work plan. When it comes as a 3-year work plan, we must actually analyze and see where are we implementing these solutions. It should come, in my opinion, in two levels. One, on the basic infrastructure of a center. So we must make sure that our system is 100% professional. It is relevant to the challenges of irrigation and fertigation, or the needs, not the challenges, that we have in our center scope. And we must be 100% professional in what we present to our farmers, because we set an example for farmers. So our systems must be model systems to farmers. The second aspect of irrigation and fertigation is, what are the questions we want to answer? What are the challenges we want to address? And here, I encourage you always narrow down the questions to 2 or 3 questions, because we cannot really take an endless number of questions. So if we want to develop KC and demonstrate ET and show actual irrigation regime that Moshe was presenting, how are we doing it? Are we going to take 5 hectares, 1 hectare, 20 hectares? And are we going to show irrigation on one block, or are we going to do a comparison? So is a comparison between 1, 2, 3 treatments? And this we will show for 3 years. And this is the type of expectation I have from project officers, to really compile a work plan that will address questions that are relevant and valid to farmers and always applicable. We are not a university in our centers, so let us address questions that are on the ground on the one hand, but farmers cannot get the answer in their field, and we there fill the gap between university and farmers' field. We are there to answer questions on an applicable level. So I want to thank you very much, Moshe. I feel like always you are a friend, but you are also an expert that I am always, you hear the depths of knowledge you come with. So I can definitely hear you for hours, and I thank you for coming at the time to our Indo-Israel project with boots on the ground in India. And today from Israel in this webinar, thank you very much.